All right, stocks rebounded today after about a week of selling. We got a little bit of a rebound. So now the question is, as it was for pretty much most of the day on any kind of financial media, was that it? Are we now starting the Santa Claus rally? Was that the selling? Were we not going to go to the old lows? We're going to bounce up here off of a higher low and really get going. Is the downward decline stage done? It seems to be that's always the question, right? Every time there's some weakness and then we have one day rally, the question is, well, are we done? You know, are we going to go back up? They usually bring on the bulls on and we talk about, in fact, I heard someone say today that because of today's move in the market, the odds of a recession for next year are now much lower, which is crazy that they put so much stock into a single day's worth of price action. That was like perfectly average, but we're going to break it down and see what people are, if they're correct or not, based off what I expect. And then we'll take a look, you know, at a trade that's not necessarily in, you know, your glamour sectors, your technology, your long duration, high growth sectors, but also has an interesting pattern set up for it, similar to some trades we've been doing here previously. So let's talk about we'll talk about how to trade that. So let's go ahead and get started. All right, today is Wednesday, December the 21st, 2022. This is the Market Outlook from MarketScholars.com. My name is David Settle. Hey, before we get started, I'd invite you to subscribe to our YouTube channel with this icon here or the red subscribe button down below. Hit the thumbs up icon to like our video. Comment on anything that stood out to you today. Join our website at MarketScholars.com for free. Follow me on Twitter for more content between the videos from day to day. And join our Market Outlook Facebook group that we've created. All right, if you're watching here on our blog, check out some of these other things here over here on the right, including our Market Outlook Live video, some of our more popular posts. Come down to the bottom, click on this heart, it opens up this tab, hit that like button. Same thing here, click on this icon, it opens up this tab, hit that like button. Again, the more you do that, it helps get our content out to all of our followers on these platforms. The more likes and comments and shares or retweets that we have, based off their algorithm, it helps promote our content. So it's a really big deal, and we appreciate those who do that for us day in and day out. All right, let's start off taking a look at the S&P 500 with the market forecast indicator. You can see today's rally here got us back up above some of these Fibonacci areas, this important confluence of Fibonacci lines that we basically got down to, and then now it's bounced back up. I wouldn't bank too much on this rally. The near intermediate line still dropping. It's still in bearish territory. The momentum line didn't spike up to high levels, so I don't expect that unless we get to some significant follow through tomorrow. You know, the near term line probably shouldn't get in the reversal zone. If it does, it would just get a little bit. Again, very something similar to this move. Again, unless we just really spike up tomorrow and follow through with this, that, you know, getting back up. Get back above 3,900. That would be a lot more significant, right? And obviously, we don't necessarily have that right now. So, you know, we are still 2% below the 30-day moving average. The market sentiment's rising, but it's not getting above 60 yet. See, it rose all the way up to 60 here. So it's not like this is the first time that we've been in this scenario. Again, last time the intermediate line crossed below that market sentiment line, when it was this low, you know, again, it started the new leg lower to the downside, and that appears to be the case here. So it's just a little bit of a pause, but not a trend changing pause. When you look at, you know, again, the weekly chart, they're only 3 days in. It's still a pretty bearish weekly candle here. It's a lower close. The PPO is falling down again. We got the red arrow last week. So we have, you know, the bearish patterns here. If you take a look at like the Dow Jones, which has been more bullish, it actually got a green arrow back today, but it still has a lower close and it's still kind of flirting with getting below this 10-week moving average. On the other hand, the NASDAQ, which has been the most bearish, that's a significantly bearish candle there. Easy, big time reversal. So things are obviously looking pretty bullish for all these indexes. You can see we got three red arrows in all these charts. So we got the pink shading. When you get multiple days of pink shading, it's one thing to get like one or two, maybe 3 days of pink shading, We've got 5 days now, and it doesn't, like, it's not even going to change tomorrow, most likely. Again, unless we get significant follow-through, which is unlikely. When you look at where we are here, like, as good of a rally as we had today, up, what, 1.5% on the S&P, we're still below the 50-day moving average. We're still below the 8-day moving average. So, you know, again, it's a nice rally because we were so oversold. You were so far away from the 8-day. If I were to come down here to the bottom, you know, we were pretty, I mean, we weren't the most below that we've been in this past year, but you know, that's a pretty low level. If you look at my cursor all the way over to the left, that was a pretty decent amount below. And now we're just coming back up, and we've seen that quite a bit. Like, we saw that over here when we started the leg lower, we made a run back up to the 8-day moving average and then stayed below. And when we started this leg lower, we also made a run back up. We weren't as low initially, but even when we were this low right here, again, we made a run back up with a 1-day rally. So when you are this low, you're going to make a move back up to the 8-day moving average. You are still, however, below the 17-day moving average. You are still below that. The 8 and 17-day are both still falling below the 30. I mean, those are all bearish signs, with the MACD still negative, like below zero, and it's still below its moving average. It did rise a little bit, but it's still below its moving average there. So you got bearish patterns all across the board here. Looking at some of the other oscillators, you can see the negative indicator still above 25. The positive did bounce up briefly here so far above 25. So we'll see, you know, they're both above 25, which is not very common. We actually had that instance over here when we had a little bit of a rally. And you can see because of that, the ADX right now is actually at its lowest level of the year. If you go all the way back over here, so if I were to follow my cursor, if you go back to here, this is the last time the ADX was this low. They weren't above 25. They were right near each other, but they were in between 20 and 25. And you can see the rally, you know, the drop we had. I mean, it was a little bit of a bounce, and then we had that drop. And then another instance over here, where the ADX was this low again, you had a little bit of a rally here, and then you can see the drop. Both lines were about right, pretty much right where we're at right now. Very, very similar. And then you can see what happens. So again, to get the ADX this low is not uncommon. And to get both lines here is not uncommon. We've seen this before. It started the whole thing back in January, and I would anticipate it's going to continue the start of this new leg lower to the downside, probably sooner rather than later. The Ichimoku cloud, we don't even have a weak bearish trend developing yet. We're still above the cloud as we transition toward the green. This is a really important level. If we can take off to the upside here and get back above 400 and stay up above the cloud and get the rate of change back to positive, great. The rate of change, though, is still negative. It's still below the price. This close is price. That's what the red line is. The red line is the current close, but it's plotted 26 days back, so we can compare where we were 26 days ago to now. So it's basically a rate of change over 26 days, the gap, and it's negative, right? So, you know, we're still, even though we're above the cloud, we're still negative on the rate of change, and we don't have any kind of trend going bearish or bullish there. If you look at the RSI and the CCI, we are still in the lower halves of the chart. They haven't, the RSI still hasn't really broken the 40 level to really confirm the breakdown, but the CCI has broken the 150 level. So, you know, they are bearish. They're not strongly bearish yet. Of course, money flow is still easily down, well down below 40. So easily in bearish territory. The Hull moving average, we did get a little bit of a turn up. Now it's a matter of whether we will close above. It's a higher close. Now we need to close above that body. I think it's unlikely we close above that body. I think we'll stay below the 20-day Hull and stay negative. So well away from those parabolic SARs there. Of course, the McClellan oscillator is also something we've been looking at. It's still negative here. You can see how it can kind of move up to even be slightly positive during these runs. During this run right here, you can see at the beginning of that leg lower, you had that little near-term run. It went positive. And then over here, during this leg lower, you had a little run there where it was slightly positive. Even right after this, you went slightly positive. So I wouldn't be surprised if we went slightly positive. But you can also see that we are headed lower and we're potentially crossing below zero pretty quickly, which is again, you know, a bearish signal, bearish path there for the S&P. The stochastics were still easily in the lower half. We're still closing in the lower half of the range. I've got the different colors here, color coded, for the type for these moves. So these three moves that we had from high to low. See that this isn't. This needs to be over here. There we go. From high to low. That's these three lines are duplicated here to kind of give us an idea of you know where we might get to by what time frame going into the beginning of February, going into January expiration into the beginning of February. And you can see even with the rally, we're still on pace pretty much for all three declines, but especially for the top one, which is a duplicate of this decline that we had back in the beginning of the year. So let's take a look now at, let's see, we didn't look at the Bollinger Bands right here in the Keltner channels. So we are in the lower half. We are out of the lower quartile, but we're still in the lower half of the bandwidth as the bandwidth is now rising. The bands are way outside of the Keltner channels. We still haven't traded below the lower Keltner, we're barely below the lower Keltner channel right there when we were really, really close to getting a negative reading on the bandwidth. We did barely get below that Keltner channel there. So again, you know, we're in a bearish mode, even if we're not necessarily bearish today. If you look at the volume and the range today, of course, you had a little bit of a gap here from 380.5 to the low at 382, so about another 2 points. So almost you were almost average on the range, you almost average on the volume down there. So 7 points and 78 million shares trading hand. When you look at those numbers, 7 points, you can see it's a pretty low range relative to the 52-week range. And then 78 million share trading hands is also pretty low. So these are hard, I mean, that's hardly like a bearish, you know, you can even see the gap to the upside wasn't more than one standard deviation, which is kind of what it needs to at least be, one standard deviation, if it's going to be considered a runaway gap where we kind of take off, we gap up and then take off and then never fill in that gap. So we're more than likely going to fill in that gap again sooner rather than later. As you can see, the Arun indicator, the positive lines is just barely crossing below 70. It's got to get all the way to zero before a low forms, typically, with the red line also dropping below 70. And typically, this also jumps up generally above 10%, or at least 2-10%, and we're only about halfway there. So obviously, there's still some work to do before we even consider a low point being formed, right? Which, again, lots of things to work on. The thing that really unsettles, that I'm unsettled with, is the VIX. The VIX is at 20 right now. It's at nearly 85%. This is a really low level for the VIX. I know we've been here before multiple times, but if you consider, if I were to go back and compare the current situation right now, we are, again, the 8 and 17 are below the, we're below the, well below the 8. The 8 jumped up towards, we're below the 50. The 8 and 17 are below the 30, right? So, again, something very similar to what we saw right here. On September the 7th, we were well below the 8, we rallied, but we were below the 50, and the 8 and 17 were below the 30. They weren't quite below the 50 yet. Same thing over here. So you know, you come back to some of these other instances, we were below the 50, the 8 and 17 day also below the 30, back on April the 28th. So April the 28th, September the 7th, right, these were all kind of moves. Well, you can even say like the 25th, but really the 28th is the day we rallied. Those were all moves similar to when we were starting new legs lower, but then we rallied in the short term. So if I were to come back over here, let's see here. Where is it? Here. No. VIX. All right. If I were to come back over here You can see on September the 7th, the VIX was at 24.64, and we were just barely dipping a little bit below 95%. Back on April the 28th, again, very similar time frame, you can see the VIX had dipped down to 29.9, and we were at a little bit above 95%. Well, now we're at, again, same exact idea, below the 50-day moving average, 8 and 17 below the 30. We were well below the 8. We were starting a leg lower, well below the 8. We bounced up. And now we're at 20. And the ratio here is, the ratio got down to 85%. And not only that, the VVIX is at 70, below 78. That is one of the lowest levels for the VVIX that we've seen in a very, very, very long time. I mean, you have to go all the way out. Again, you can kind of see, you have to go all the way out to 2019 before COVID that we had a few instances down to this level where we're at right now. That's a really, really low level for the VIX. When the VIX and the VVIX are both really low, the VIX low relative to VIX3M, you know, they both set you up for, especially with their correlation kind of moving back up towards 100%, they're both setting up for a significant move to the upside, especially with the VIX compressed as much as it is. Remember, the VIX is, that's what the VVIX is pretty much measuring, but the VIX itself has compressed to really, really low levels here. If I were to go to like a 5-year chart here, you see how the VIX is really compressed all year long. It was pretty, the ATR was really high at the beginning of the year, and it is just compressed all year long to these really low levels. That typically you see a, you know, when we get a big spike to the upside, you see a big jump to the downside here. And we haven't really seen that, not like some of these other instances where you, when you get that first initial jump, then you spike down. But these are low, low levels for the VIX to be as compressed as it is. It is set, especially with the move that we're seeing today, it is set up for a big jump to the upside. Big jump to the upside. Now, I'm not talking like the 80 or the 70, but getting back up to 30 is a big jump because that's a 50% move now that we're back at 20 and with the VVIX so low. So that's been a little concerning. The fact that, you know, here we are starting a new leg lower, which typically is, you know, has shown up in elevated VIX levels, but we're not seeing that now, you know, with the compression that's typically leads to the VIX tsunamis, which is what Andrew Thrasher calls him. That's the concern going into the beginning of, well, really going into the supposed Santa Claus rally period, but especially going into a new year, the January period, which, you know, again, season, from a seasonality standpoint, of course, we're heading into the, you know, fabled Santa Claus rally time frame. But when you look at SPY here at the, you know, in December, we tend to be, you know, here, let's go out 20 years. We tend to be relatively bullish, again, going into the end of the year. Again, this is kind of Santa Claus little period. But then January and into mid-February, we're not that bullish. And if you go out just the last 5 years here, you know, it has been a relatively bullish period all the way up to mid-February. But that has not been traditionally the case. It's actually been relatively flat. Going into this one period. And then, of course, by the end of March, we're down for the year. And that was the case this year. We were down for most of January into and February into March. So, you know, we got that kind of scenario occurring with the VIX at pretty darn, not extremely low levels, but pretty extreme low levels considering the condition we're in, below the 200-day moving average, below the 50, well below the 8, and the 8.17 crossing below the 30. And that typically is elevated volatility levels, and that's not the case right now. And not only that, but you can see not only has the VIX compressed, but you can also see this is the gamma exposure. So this is kind of the orange line here measures the demand for call buying. And if I were to zoom out, you can see the demand for call buying among retail investors is really, really low, which causes interesting phenomenon. This is the 10-day average of the put-call ratio, the equity put-call ratio, has reached pretty high levels. Again, not necessarily because there's an increase in put buying, because the VIX is pretty low. So there's actually a kind of a little bit of a decrease in put buying, but call buying has dropped dramatically from where it was. In fact, if you look across the left, these are lower levels than what we've seen all these other years, going back to 15, 14, 15, 16. We didn't have very high peaks either, but you can see how we just blew up in the call buying demand in 2020, 2021 with the Robinhood stay-at-home phenomenon. It really caused the put call ratio to drop below its normal ranges to significantly lower levels because, again, because of all the call buying making the ratio get smaller since the call's in the denominator. But now it's really jumped back up to the upside and not a spike. Like last time it got up here, it was a spike. This time we've been just kind of gradually going parabolic move to the upside. Again, with the lack of call buying and the lack of put buying, it's going to be interesting to see how this ultimately plays out. What will make this ratio come back down again? You would expect that it would be again, a significant increase in call buying or a further decrease, so a breakdown of the VIX below 20. That would be your typical the typical pattern for the expectation here. But considering that puts are already really low, I'm a little concerned about where this ratio ultimately may end up headed. Again, with the lack of call buying and with the relatively low VIX too. You would expect, considering how bearish the markets have been, you would expect here, again, you go out to, we're trading near the 200-week moving average. The expectation is call buying should be relatively strong because we are so low. You got maybe a little bit of a head and shoulders, inverted head and shoulders bottom forming, right? There should be an increase in call buying, a significant increase in call buying as we get to these lows, setting up for a Tom Lee rally up to new highs. But there's not only not been a significant increase in call buying, there has been an extreme decrease in call buying, which suggests a lot of people really are not that bullish at all going into 2023. All right, now let's take a look at what's driving this price action. You can see again over the last 3 months that the developed market stocks are just really, really doing very well. Let's take a look at just today alone on this little bit of a rally that we've had. December 21st, and let's just go out to the last few minutes, a few minute charts. Obviously, US equities outpaced today. Commodities did really well. Gold was down, the dollar's down, bonds down. I'm pretty much risk on. If you go back out to last week, so we started with last Tuesday is when the CPI report came out. Really, from that day on, you can see we started the day really strong. But then from that period, US equities were the biggest losers, down. You can see where the Qs are down, IWM, SPY. Gold had been a big winner. Commodities were a relatively outperformer. And you can see bonds down here was also a loser, but at least outpacing equities. But since with today's move, remember, these were the biggest movers to the upside, US equities. Bonds were flat or down today, at least underperformers, and gold is an underperformer, and the dollar is an underperformer. The dollar was down, but had been outpacing equities as well and outpacing bonds. The only thing the dollar did not outperform was corporate bonds, high yield, as well as commodities and gold. So it looked like today was basically just a bounce back up of everything that had not been doing very well. Like again, mainly US equities. They had been the biggest losers over the past week. And so they were the biggest winners today. And it doesn't appear to be necessarily anything more than that's driving today's move. If you look at long-term bonds, remember they had been really dropping over this past week along with equities. They're still down below the 50-day, the 17-day moving average, excuse me. And you can see the MACD and stochastics dropping significantly below their moving averages. So bonds are in a downward move, which again coincides with the rally in yields back up to 3.7%. And they're moving up relatively sharply, well above their 17 and now 30-day moving averages. After pretty much a week ago, being down to what, 3.5%, and now we're at 3.64. That's obviously having an impact on the yield spreads. Those are something we've been kind of keeping an eye on. The yield spread for the 10-year 3 month is now only 70 basis points. It was in the 80s. And the 2-10 years at 56, and this was well down into the 70s and even got down to 84 over here. So pretty significant moves higher in the yield spreads. Mainly you can see the three month at 4.34%, the 2 year kind of hovering at 4.2, but the 10 year starting to rise, and that's why the yield spreads are moving higher. And we talked about that previously. Remember, when yield spreads rise, it's actually pretty bearish for equities. And there's two scenarios where yield spreads can rise. One is the Fed's cutting rates. Obviously, they don't do that in bull markets. They do that, you know, when you're bearish. And then the other scenario for yield spreads to rise is for long-term yields to rise. And that's what's happening here. You still have very relatively high odds for more rate hikes. Obviously, 100% odds that you get at least 25 basis points in February. There's still pretty much a 1 in 3 chance, a little bit more than 1 in 4, that you're going to get a 50 basis point by February. And by March, there's about a 67% chance that you'll get to 5% by March. So pretty high odds that you're going to be at 5% at some point. If not February, then most likely March. And again, that typically means that, you know, rates have to rise to get to that point, especially here on the short end of the curve, especially that 3 month. So if the 2 year says, hey, the Fed's done raising rates, which is kind of what, considering we're at 4.5 right now, the 2 year appears to be saying that the Fed's done raising rates. If the Fed does continue to raise rates, which they're expected to do, then you're going to get a pretty significant inversion here between Fed funds and the 2 year, which, you remember, the 2 year price is where they expect the Fed funds to get to. The 10 year is got other aspects of, a little bit of inflation expectations as well as economic growth expectations involved in here. So not necessarily the best sign, with this rising, which is cutting, making the yield spread go back up towards zero, that's been bearish for equities all year, and you would expect it will be bearish for equities again. Commodities, you notice, are also trying to bottom and work their way up, which again, it's not necessarily what people want to see, right? If the Fed's going to stop raising rates, it's going to be because inflation's in check because commodities have come off their high levels. Though you got to keep in mind too that, you know, when you look at commodities, let's look at the rate of change here for commodities over a quarter. 63 basis points, 63 days, you can see we've been pretty negative after being relatively positive. Remember, the inflation really hit its head over here. Like, we made this strong run on inflation in March. We had a strong run in commodities, and then we kind of, settled down a little bit, made another run, settled down, and then took off at the beginning of this year. And that's, inflation really made its peak here in June, as commodities themselves have made their peak. But you can see now commodities have dropped. They're pretty much done dropping, it appears, and then maybe making a leg higher, which again is the last thing the market wants to see, because again, that just raises inflation expectation. Remember, the inflation levels really started to take off in March of last year, and we're still way higher now than we were back then. Still pretty bearish peak when you look at some of these weekly charts for commodities. We've been flirting with this death cross environment. We're getting lower closes on a week-to-week basis, but you can also see how we're kind of basing here, and you wonder if we're going to start to roll back up or start to correct. Either way, it's one of those catch-22s, right? We go back up, inflation expectations continue to move higher, right? We go back up. If we go back down, then we're correcting, which is always occurs during bear markets or bearish markets. So it's a catch-22. One will lead to higher inflation expectations again, which means the Fed's not done with what they're trying to do. And the other is deflationary, which is typically bearish for equities, but ultimately would be bullish for bonds at some point in time, because then that would know, this would turn around and be considered a safe haven asset, even if this weekly candle here and potentially closing back below the 8 week would be bearish, right? It'd be, you know, we made this run up to the 30 week, failed, and now starting our way lower. Of course, the dollar is also a big factor, and it's sitting right at that 50 week moving average, and MACD histogram starting to roll up for multiple weeks now. So it appears that it's trying to form a low point, which means the MACD itself is close to its own bottom and will, you know, can potentially start to roll up. And that's typically means that the dollar is done making its run, at least this current downward run. Doesn't mean we have to go up to new highs, but you would expect that, you know, the support at the 50 will hold, and then we'll see what happens when we make a run back up towards the 8 and the 17 and potentially the 30-day averages there. Let's take a look at the sector rotations, how their sector moves, and see how they perform today. And again, on a typical risk-on day, you would expect that we'd see technology and communication services and consumer discretionary be our biggest winners. And they kind of were, but really your biggest winners were industrials, financials, and energy. And those, again, have been the bigger winners for the bulk of the period going, you know, this rally that we've had going into that December the 13th timeframe. Since the 13th, remember, that's not been, like, these three areas have been the biggest losers. You would expect that they would have been the biggest winners. Energy was already up going into today, way better than everything else. So were industrials and financials. So the fact that they're continuing to be the biggest winners on the upward move doesn't necessarily, like, give me confidence that this is like a trend-changing rally. I would have really expected to see these three big losers be by far the easiest three big winners. And while they were winners, they weren't the clear winners, and they weren't by themselves. Some of these other cyclical areas, which were already outperforming to begin with, outperformed again today. And that doesn't sound to me like a change in this oversold trend. It tells me that, again, we're kind of making one last hurrah to the upside with the things that led us to the upside previously. People are trying to hope that that this is the low point and we're just going to continue the move that we had previously here. So for our trade idea of the day, I wanted to take a look at Philip Morris here. So let's take a look at that stock. This is kind of not necessarily, this is a staple, consumer staple. Sometimes trades along with some of these consumer cyclical areas, but more of a staple stock. You can see the intermediate line fell below, the stock fell below its 30-day moving average, pretty significant gap to the downside. In fact, one of its bigger gaps that we've seen here in a while. It was a 2-standard deviation gap to the downside that we ultimately held most of that drop. And like I said, got below the intermediate line, getting below its market sentiment line. Short-term sentiment also dropping down into bearish levels. You take a look at some of the other charts, it almost looks very similar to the S&P, just doesn't have the near-term bounce because we're still going down. But you can see we had been bullish. We got the lower close. As of right now, we are closing below that body. Yes, we have an upper and lower shadow, but you've got a little bit of a transition candle forming this week so far. The week's not over with. When you look at these lines, you can see how we crossed below the 17 and the 30 on the same day. There we go. So here's the break below the 17 and the 30 and almost below the 50. Not quite below the point of control yet. So that's still there as a support level. But look at your MACD and stochastics. MACD has been in convergence mode, finally kind of breaking that convergence mode and moving lower to the downside. When you look at the DMI, if I can type in the right symbol. Okay, the DMI, you can see the negative indicator is working its way up towards 25. The negative is working its way down below 20, so they're moving in the right directions. The RSI and the CCI look very similar again to the broader market. The CCI dropped all the way down to minus 200, so definitely confirming the break in the lower half of the chart. And we are in the lower half of the chart, not quite below 40 yet, but working our way again in that direction. You can see from a Bollinger Band standpoint, we are in the lower half of the chart. After being in the upper half for so long, we're in the lower half of the bandwidth. The bandwidth actually moved inside of the Keltner channels. So you got the red dot, which typically, again, separates one momentum move from another, which you would expect would be to the downside. So it sets us up for, you know, a bearish trade. And so what I decided to do on this trade was to do a bear put spread buy at the mid 30 delta, sell, in this case, two strikes away to keep my risk down and keep the cost down. You can see I position size for a normal position. Get rid of the simulated trade. The normal directional position, so half my normal position. So following $500. Our normal risk is 1,000. And then you can see I'm up over 4 to 1, close to 5, so about 4.5 to 1 reward to risk ratio, which is perfect, right? A pretty aggressive trade, but, you know, again, banking on the fact that we'll be breaking out, continuing the breakdown that we saw today below these moving averages and working a new leg lower to the downside. In this case, you would expect coming off of this divergent high point to be down to potentially a lower low point. All right, well, that does it for today. You've heard from me now, and I want to hear from you. Use that link popping out in the top right corner of your screen. That takes you to our Market Outlook forums. Open up any new thread with any questions or comments you have. Reply to anybody else's thread. And let's keep this conversation going in between videos. Again, thank you very much for watching. Remember to subscribe to our YouTube channel. Hit that thumbs up icon. Comment on the video. Subscribe to our website at marketscholars.com for free. Like us on Twitter and Facebook. Have a great rest of your Wednesday night, everybody, and we'll see you all next time.